Greetings. My name is Dr. Giselle C. Shorter. I lead the National School and System Redesign Portfolio and support the K-12 policy efforts at the Rakes Foundation. The heartbeat of the K-12 portfolio is the Building Equitable Learning Environments, BEL, network. Collectively, the BEL membership is advancing our education system to ensure the intellectual, social, emotional, cultural growth and well-being of all young people. My life's work is rooted in a deep belief that a just society starts with an equitable education. Collectively, we believe we can only be healthy and strong as a nation when every educational institution is a place where all children can learn, develop, and thrive. The evidence and research are abundantly clear in support of those ideas. Both confirm two things. One, a young person's academic, social, and emotional development are inextricably linked. And two, the quality of a child's learning environment, their experiences, and access to opportunities determine their developmental and academic outcomes. 2 years into the COVID-19 pandemic, it is evident that though young people are resilient, our education system is inequitably designed and insufficiently resourced to meet the challenges of this crisis. When the pandemic hit the U.S. in March of 2020, we all took to our homes for safety. The concept of home as a physically and emotionally safe environment is not new. There was probably no more difficult time to be homeless than during this period of COVID confinement. Truly committing to recovery means ensuring the unique needs of our most vulnerable and highly mobile students are being met. Anything less is unworthy of our country and what we, those entrusted with developing policy and stewarding practice, are capable of doing. Schools, particularly those in communities that have experienced decades of underinvestment and have been disproportionately impacted by the pandemic, are not currently equipped to provide the range of student supports with the scale, personalization, and intensity the moment demands. Simply put, students, educators, and parents need more help to recover and thrive. We continue to hear that few students have access to the staff and supports that can help them address mental health challenges that emerged and in some cases have been exacerbated by the COVID-related stress and traumatic experiences that our students have navigated. Increased access to social, emotional, and mental health supports for all students is vital to address impacts of this global pandemic. Often, when we face challenges, lack of sufficient funding is a major reason we struggle to do what's needed. Luckily, we have the advantage of over $135 billion in federal resources to help us not just recover, but move towards schools that are prepared to meet the diverse and unique needs of each and every student. If we use them correctly, ARP funds can help us build a bridge from schools that are under-resourced and struggling to meet students' needs to places that provide rich learning environments, positive developmental relationships, wraparound services, and connections with families and community. Clearly, this is what students deserve. Research shows that children and young people learn more, report feeling safer, and develop more trusting and dynamic relationships with their peers and other adults when the school environment is organized to see, understand, and deploy resources targeted to their needs when they need them. Recent CDC data tells us that in 2021, more than a third, 37% to be specific, of high school students reported experiencing poor mental health during the COVID-19 pandemic, and 44% reported they persistently felt sad or hopeless during the past year. The good news is that the same study highlighted that a sense of being cared for, supported, and belonging at school made a world of difference. Youth who felt connected to adults and peers at school were significantly less likely than those who did not to report persisting feelings of sadness or hopelessness, right? And so that's 35% versus 53% that they seriously considered attempting suicide, 14 versus 26%, or attempted suicide, 6 versus 12%. Unfortunately, fewer than half, 47% of youth reported feeling close to people at school during the pandemic. And that's where we all come in. There are many models with proven or promising evidence for how schools can attune to students' mental health, social and emotional needs, and well-being. American rescue plans are enabling schools and districts to begin or deepen their investment in these models. President Biden issued a call to action as part of his unity agenda during the State of the Union speech. He asked Americans to support student recovery by becoming tutors, mentors, and stepping up to fill many other needed roles. Parents, schools, and community-based nonprofits can and must heed the call by working together to ensure that every child gets a quality education, one that recognizes their unique needs and provides them the resources they need to reach their full potential, no matter their race or background or system involvement, including homelessness.
I love being a principal, I really do. I get an opportunity to see students enter at 3 years old, and in some cases they're leaving at 14, ready to take on the world.
I pledge allegiance to the flag.
Across America, many students in high poverty and urban school districts face an uphill battle. It's not because they didn't finish their homework or study enough. The barriers to success are more severe. An empty stomach, a stay in a homeless shelter, a lack of access to arts or sports, a lack of connections. This is where the staff of City Connects fills the void, creating the right connections for students.
City Connects is one of the critical components of our school improvement. For me, it's been this program that's allowed us to really look at each child and say, this is what this child needs to have in place, both in school and out of school. And there's no better program that does it.
My role at the school is to manage a large K-8 school. It's a state turnaround school trying to go through rapid improvement. We've been able to transition from a school in crisis to a stable school focusing on literacy, thanks to the support from City Connects.
City Connects is a school-based model of student support. Our staff works with teachers and families to identify the strengths and needs of each student in a school, and works with the school to connect them to a uniquely tailored set of services in the school and community.
What poverty does is really limit the life chances of our children. It limits their opportunities for education. It limits their opportunities to thrive. And if we look at the difference between kids that are achieving well in schools and kids that are struggling, poverty is the difference.
We think about City Connects as an evidence-based student support practice that addresses the out-of-school factors that influence a child's ability to achieve and learn in school.
A full-time school site coordinator, typically a school counselor or social worker, works with principals, teachers, and school staff to connect each student with appropriate services.
As a school site coordinator, I'm able to help provide supports and resources to students and really connect with teachers and administrators.
C City Connects collaborates with hundreds of community partners to deliver tailored supports such as after-school programs, mentoring, family and medical services, and healthy life skills programs.
So we're going to go over how to choose a specific healthy snack and how you can be creative with it too.
The City Connects model is a brilliant model in that it helps other service providers optimize what they're doing.
They know the resources, they know the needs, they know the children as well as the teachers and the parents. And so it's great to have that one place that I can go to.
Just in the last 2 months, we've provided a new pair of shoes to each of our children and a new winter coat for impoverished families. It's a big deal.
We're making sure that we're documenting which services students are getting, how we've communicated with families, the meetings we've had with teachers.
Our evidence indicates that City Connects really works and makes a difference for children academically and socially.
City Connects has been rigorously evaluated. Starting in elementary school, City Connects students significantly outperform their peers academically. After leaving City Connects, they surpass comparison students on statewide tests. They also show gains in motivation and behavior, and later are less likely to drop out of high school.
The kids coming from the highest levels of poverty don't access those supports that are available in the community unless there's something to support them. I think City Connects really fills the gaps for an urban school system to provide the kind of support families and students need in an organized, effective manner.
There are not enough resources to go around. We have families who are dealing with unemployment. There are students who have dealt with trauma. And so in order to get to the point where you can educate them and that they can focus on academics, you can't just look the other way and pretend that those other needs don't exist.
City Connects provides the ways in which we begin to chip away at those needs, understand the needs, and then support the teachers so that they are part of a structure, part of a system that supports the whole child.
Teachers report high levels of satisfaction with City Connects because it creates the right connections for students. It leverages the resources of the community to meet the needs of each student and promote their unique strengths with a practice that's easy to deploy and scale up in districts.
I absolutely would recommend City Connects. In fact, I have recommended City Connects. The program and the coordinators are an essential support for me and for our entire faculty and parent body.
I've been in schools where City Connects has not been. And I'm at a school that has City Connects. Not having it showed me that this is a program that I want to keep in my school for as long as, for forever.
Bye, Thomas. See you guys.
Bye.
I can't tell you how much this program means to us. Marion University has been wanting to bring City Connects to Indiana for several years, and in conjunction with bringing City Connects to Indiana, we were able to launch the Center for Vibrant Schools, which is where City Connects is kind of housed within the university and really serves as the community outreach and K-12 outreach arm of Marion University. The Center for Vibrant Schools launched City Connects in 34 schools across the state of Indiana, geographically dispersed amongst the state. We're getting ready to expand City Connects in several other Indiana schools. We're looking at expanding to approximately 40 more schools over the course of the next year. We're also working with 7 schools in Ohio throughout the Dayton area. We kind of acquired them in our partnership with Boston College, and they've been implementing for about 12 years. So it's a really great kind of learning experience for us to see the implementation of City Connects that's been happening for several years and how we can use kind of their skill set and knowledge to implement in Indiana. We're working in several different types of schools, charter schools, public schools, non-public schools, all of varying sizes and age groups. City Connects is available for K-12, so we can really serve
any age of student before they enter college, which is kind of nice. And as we know, in Indiana, school choice is something that creates a very varied education environment in Indiana. So City Connects is able to kind of adapt to those different learning environments and the needs of those different students. So City Connects is really appropriate for the time that we are currently in, with the pandemic creating and exacerbating student learning loss. This has been the opportunity that's really kind of been able to feed the need for City Connects. So while City Connects can greatly benefit students pre-pandemic, with the pandemic, it's only perpetuated those ongoing educational challenges. So City Connects really allows a really specific and intentional way to address learning loss as it relates to the pandemic. And we know it's going to take several years to address that learning loss. And so City Connects is something that can kind of follow that student as they kind of re-acclimate post-pandemic.
So my goal while here is to make sure that all children have what they need to be successful with their academics here, just to see more of them succeed, to kind of handle some of those root problems that are in the home or outside of school. So for the ones that are having those issues, I like to get those issues settled, get them what they need so they can succeed here at school. So. My name is Ramed Page. I am the family navigator slash City Connects coordinator here at Grissom Elementary School. I think it's more of a family culture here. Middle of Muncie, we have a few elementary schools here, so typical elementary school. Being from the community, I know a lot of, I was born and raised in Muncie and now I'm here working. So I know a lot of the families. It helps me with the kids. Hey, I know your grandma, or I know your mom. Hey, you should get it in order. So I recommend schools work with City Connects because Indiana has never had the program. So when I came through school here, there was no whole class review. So I might have been missed on some things that should have been that I should have had during school that weren't there for me. So I think having this program will be able to help out more of those students who are slipping through the cracks, or just the teacher can't always know or might forget, or you know, not have that extra person there like, hey, there's something going on. So I think having the City Connects program will be good to help those that just never received help, or it's here, it's some here now. So, and it's going to help out. I see it helping out a lot.
In this next academic year, we're going to be working specifically with the mayor's office. So we have partnered with them to bring on 12 schools on the far east side of Indianapolis. Again, varied sizes, varied age groups, but we're really excited to be able to serve that community. That's one of the communities that really needs this kind of social services, holistic student support approach in order to address the needs of students that live in these neighborhoods. So we're excited to be working with the mayor's office to be able to not only implement City Connects, but to be able to take a look at those communities as a whole and be able to use the information from City Connects to inform some larger citywide and community level types of decision making in terms of offering new and more supports in certain areas based on the information that we're able to gather through the practice of City Connects.
We are here at Phelan Leadership Academy for a very special announcement benefiting Far East Side Indianapolis students. For the past couple of years, students, well, they've had to endure a lot. But even prior to the pandemic, many Indianapolis students faced obstacles in and outside the classroom, which frankly inhibited achievement. Today, the City of Indianapolis, in partnership with Marion University, is proud to launch the City Connects initiative, a $7.5 million investment into nearly a dozen Far East Side public schools over the next 3 years. Administered by Marion University's Center for Vibrant Schools, the City Connects initiative will strengthen efforts to deliver support services to students who find themselves in need. City Connects will serve more than 3,400 students across 11 traditional public and public charter schools on the Far East Side. Every student at a participating school will receive an individualized plan to meet critical non-academic needs. Those needs could include mental health services, food assistance. They could even include access to after-school programming and other opportunities. The City Connects initiative is yet another city program that we are able to fund through federal dollars awarded to Indianapolis by the American Rescue Plan. ARPA funding will cover managing and implementation costs, and they will also allow for the creation of online service hubs. Importantly, City Connects already has a proven 20-year track record in the city of Boston, the program's founding city. It has shown to increase student attendance, decrease dropout rates, improve state test scores, and increase the likelihood of a student being able to pursue a post-secondary education. Now, where I come from, that's called a win, 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 win. We look forward to working with IPS Superintendent Dr. Alicia Johnson, as well as our charter school leaders like Earl Phelan, to realize what I believe is a critically important vision, a vision for the future of Indianapolis, a vision for the future of the Far East Side, and most importantly, a vision for the thousands of students that this initiative will impact.
Thank you to everyone with the United States Department of Education for having us here today to talk about the great work our school teams are doing to engage students throughout the pandemic and beyond. Here at Metro Nashville Public Schools, the ethos that drives the work we do every day is every student known. This means understanding the hopes, dreams, aspirations, skills, and challenges of our students so that we can layer in the appropriate programs, support, encouragement, and interventions to help them succeed. Like most school districts across the country,
We had to start the 2020-21 school year in a remote setting due to the pandemic. While this change in operations was necessary to protect the overall health and welfare of our students and staff, we knew that it would present challenges to the social-emotional health of our students. So we developed a program whereby each student received a regular check-in from a caring adult who could ask probing questions and assure that their needs were being met. The Navigator program was born out of a unique need and necessity, but is something that we believe will grow and evolve as a consistent and essential program in the years ahead. And we could not have done it without the funding provided through the federal ESSER program and the American Recovery Plan that was championed by President Biden and passed through Congress. Now, I'll turn it over to my team, led by Dr. Kerry Randolph, our Chief of Strategy, and Dr. Michelle Springer, our Chief of Student Support Services, who will walk through in greater detail how this program works and how it has transformed our ability to connect with and support the children we serve.
I am Dr. Michelle Springer, and I serve as Chief of Student Support Services in Metro Nashville Public Schools.
And I'm Kerry Randolph. I'm a Chief Strategy Officer for Metro Nashville Public Schools, and we're excited to share with you some important work that we launched in the school year 2021. And we're really humbled to join you today to share the work on behalf of our amazing educators and staff in Metro Nashville Public Schools. A little bit about us. We are a large urban school system with almost 80,000 students. We proudly serve diverse communities with a student body of more than 20,000 English learners. Almost 80% of students are low income, and more than 70% are students of color. So we want to start off and explain with the Navigator work really connected strongly to our why. In alignment with our vision of every student known, cared for, respected, and supported, we launched Navigator in the school year 2021 as an intentional support that matched each student with an adult in their school who conducted regular one-on-one check-ins focused on building strong relationships and connecting students to needed supports. Navigator supports our commitment to personalized learning and individualized supports for every student, creating intentional connections as well as academic, SEL, and transition-focused outcomes. As you heard Dr. Battle explain, we knew that these intentional connections were more important than ever when we opened schools virtually in the fall of 2020. Our community had experienced devastating tornadoes in March of the same year, and that was followed closely by shutdown due to the pandemic. We were concerned about our students and families. How would we know how they were, what they needed? We moved quickly to establish Navigator with inspiration from the Education Redesign Lab at Harvard and building on work that was already happening in the district. Most importantly, we created Navigator in response to concerns we heard across stakeholder groups. From students, how will I get the support I need? Who will help me? Parents, how will my students stay connected to their school community? From teachers, how will I know how my students are? Acting with urgency, we developed a plan and baseline for support. Every student would be assigned a Navigator who would check in with them via video conference or phone every week, respond to their needs identified, and if more support was needed, then connect them or refer them. We supported schools with scripts for Navigator calls and short and targeted PD. We stood up a rudimentary data system, which we knew wasn't perfect, but we listed immediate needs and developed systems to meet those needs and have continued to refine over time. We held office hours for schools. We pushed in to support when challenges arose. We let 100 flowers bloom above the baseline check-ins that were required under the vision of every student known. The concept was really simple. Weekly check-ins to build strong relationships and intentional questions to make sure every student was connected to what they need. Early check-ins focused on housing needs, food insecurity, technology needs, mental health, but they also included questions on academics and social-emotional learning. Navigators supported the needs and entered data, which we visualized through simple dashboards available at the school and district levels. Navigator leadership teams at the school, often the counselor, social worker, the principal, and others, reviewed the data and provided support. District teams brought capacity by connecting directly with families on housing needs and supported Avon identification under McKinney-Vento. We monitor data to connect nonprofits and others to the needs identified. That's that actionable data you see. The Navigator also served as the internal connector for a student advocate, connecting them with needed supports and reaching out for help when they weren't sure how to help. And just a note on the role of the Navigator and who served in that role. A Navigator was any adult in the building who could build a strong relationship, teachers, paraprofessionals, front office staff, and so forth. Navigators build relationships and identify needs. We also knew for the system to work, navigators had to be supported and connected themselves. We also needed to minimize preparation to maximize impact. There was a lot going on in the beginning of the 2020 school year. We provided short training scripts and resource lists. We provided translation support for our English, our non-English speaking families, and worked to tie Navigator in with other supports at the school level, such as multi-tiered systems of support, our attendance teams, and so forth. So we worked hard to integrate the system of Navigator across the 2021 school year.
In addition, we knew that as we worked to identify specific needs for our students, staff, and even our families, having that universal process and tool would be key to sustainability. And so this is a quick representation of our initial data system that was used, which is a simple Microsoft form that feeds into a Power BI dashboard. Currently, we're in a different place, in a better place, but initially this met our identified needs. And this dashboard provided that real-time data on areas of concerns linked to the scripts that the navigators were using. And you can see those areas here, as Dr. Randolph mentioned earlier, the technology, the learning conditions, the academics, the social-emotional learning, and even our basic needs being met. And with each school using this check-in system and documentation form process, which then populated into a dashboard, we were able to see real-time needs across the district and at the school level. And we were better able to make the necessary system-wide shifts to mobilize supports and resources to schools during these uncharted waters at the time. Here's a summary of the 2020-2021 data. Less than 3% of our families opted out of this level of support, which really truly reinforced the need. One interesting data point is the number of collaborative referrals. And a collaborative referral is completed when a student's need needs to be connected to internal and external services. We found out that a collaborative referral was generated for about every 125 check-ins. So the need was great. We anticipated this rate to go down over time, but it actually didn't. It remained constant throughout the year. And we kind of identified two reasons and causations. One, as the relationships between the navigator and the student became stronger, students were more likely to share their needs. And navigators were more likely to recognize those needs. And secondly, students and their families were in changing circumstances all the time. And what was true last check-in might not be true a few weeks later. And so we needed that on the ground, on time data on a regular basis. We'd like for you to hear from the Navigator lead at one of our amazing high schools and one of our amazing students at Hillwood High School, a true pioneer in this work.
My name is Celia Jolly, and I am the Academy Principal of the ADC and Engineering Academy.
My name is Angelique Kimbo. I'm a senior at Hillwood High School, and I also serve as a senior student representative on the MNPS Board of Education.
And the question that we'll focus on is, what has Navigator meant for our students, and where do we see it going in the future? We've seen an increase in a request for services as a result of the Navigator survey. It's given us the opportunity to really zone in on what our kids and our families need. As a result of that, we have opened up our community resource room, we've opened up the Hope Room, and we have employed a Community Achieves facilitator. Let's hear from one of our students on what this program has impacted at our school.
So I feel like it's really important that students have a way to say what they need, further needs to be addressed. In MNPS, every student is known, and through the Navigator survey, students can have their needs be addressed in a way that is private, as well as having collective data for school admin to act accordingly.
And in addition to that, we use the Sown to Grow program, and we are a pilot school for that. That has helped us in so many ways. When we were virtual, that allowed us to zone in on what our kids needed in terms of SEL, social and emotional learning. It also allowed children to be anonymous with things that they were providing us, information that they shared with their teachers. It gave the teachers a chance to give kids feedback with the information that they shared. But again, it was a safe space for our kids to share things about themselves. Anjali, anything you'd like to add?
I really enjoyed Sown to Grow, and I know speaking from my peers as well, just having something to write down your feelings, maybe you're having a bad day, was really significant and impactful for us. Sometimes talking to a teacher face-to-face is really scary, and typically that isn't really the case for students needing to talk to teachers unless it's a last resort. So just having mental health be put out of focus is really important, and I really appreciate that for our school, and hopefully it could be spread throughout the district as well.
All right. Thank you.
No, it's great to hear how Navigator is connecting students to the resources they need, which you heard Dr. Jolly mention in the safe space it is creating for students to share concerns and challenges. Our students will always remember how we supported them through their most neediest of times. So Dr. Jolly and Anjali mentioned Sown to Grow, and in 2021-22 school year, we expanded our Navigator work to include a weekly social-emotional check-in with students. This is a simple check-in system, and it has provided, though, powerful data and created a safe space for our students. Students report how they're feeling and responded to open-ended prompts. It's a strong self-reflection tool, and as you heard Anjali mention, students share things through Sown to Grow that they sometimes don't feel comfortable sharing face-to-face. Navigators respond to students' responses, and students use their Sown to Grow dashboard and Navigator check-ins through a student-led conference system to reflect on their social emotional well-being. We really, truly want to make sure that we are elevating our student voice, elevating our student need, and aligning supports accordingly. Here's an example of the school and district dashboard. Some critical concerns are flagged for immediate follow-up, and we can also monitor the self-reported emotions of students across schools and the system, and again, align supports and resources accordingly and in real time. Through implementation, of course, we've had some lessons learned. The needs of our students have evolved and expanded, and more on-demand resources are needed to better align supports and services. So really understanding those needs and aligning accordingly are critical. Yes, we have some non-negotiables. We also have freedom to innovate. At this point, no one knows their building better than the school leader. They're in the day-to-day on-the-ground execution and implementation. And so we provide a framework with basic expectations. However, schools know how they need to make the necessary adjustments for strong implementation to meet the needs of their students. Any gaps that we identified really truly helped us to refine our practice as a support hub. At the district level, we identified that we could tighten
and really refine our way of tracking and monitoring the referrals that we receive and how we follow up accordingly. And lastly, as mentioned before, the real-time data is absolutely powerful. We are supporting a large urban school district with communities in crisis. The data illuminated a continuum of service that was needed for our schools, and they're counting on us to respond. And so we knew this wasn't a nice to have, but rather a necessity for all schools.
And I'll add to the lessons learned that Michelle shared. One of the things that was really important in the work and that we've expanded over time is really meeting schools where they are, help to move the work forward. We provide patient consistent support around that baseline of every student receiving regular navigator check-ins and weekly Stone to Grow check-ins through the platform. So we've pushed in to support those expectations and met schools where they are in that journey. And we've had some schools that have run ahead and gone deeper in their implementation. We've also know something that all of us know in K-12, that this work has to be owned and supported at the building level to be effective. But what we found is very important in the work was establishing that initial vision of every student known. Once we had that initial vision and the why, it's easy for schools to connect the work they're doing with Navigator and Stone to Grow to that why for their communities and their students. And look, we were pretty opportunistic is the word I would use. This is a lift. It is more work in some ways, but it's the right work. And when we launched this as the school year 2021 was opening up, it was a felt need for our stakeholders. And so we were able to do something on a scale that might not have been possible in what we'll call a typical school year. And what's been great about that is it's allowed us to build on that for the future. One quick note, to build strong relationships, we have really supported schools and been very clear that caseloads for navigators must stay low. So no navigator should serve more than 12 to 15 students in order to build those strong relationships that we know are super important to be successful. And then how has it helped? So you saw some of the data that Michelle shared earlier for the 2021 school district. We have deeper implementation now across all of our 132 schools. And really what we're finding is that data has been a powerful tool both for us at the district level and at the school level. And we have data to show that we need more mental health supports, that we need more school counselors. We need more social workers. We actually have the data to make that ask to our community. And we've seen the community step up. And we, for example, are funding advocacy centers across all of our elementary schools. And the Navigator data was one of the pieces of evidence we used to demonstrate that need. We are reaching universal implementation across all our diverse schools. We have very diverse schools serving very diverse communities, and we see a continuum of implementation from that baseline, as I mentioned before, and that's been really exciting. And our job in the support hub is to continue to let those flowers bloom, as I mentioned before. We've been able to be responsive to shifting needs. We started with those basic needs, as Michelle mentioned, with technology, food, and they've become increasingly academic and mental health over time. We are better able to meet the needs of our special populations, particularly our students experiencing homelessness. Both the identification process and the connection for those families has been easier because we can push in at the district level with schools to support those families. It's really, as we've mentioned, helped us stay connected to our why of every student known, cared for, respected, and supported. And for schools and for us at the district level, it's underlined the power and impact of parent engagement. We've had schools say, you know, this was work, but it's the right work. And the parent engagement that got started in the 2021 school year, we want to continue because we see how impactful it is for our students and the work that we do with them every day. So what's next for us? You heard us outline kind of the launch moment in time for the 2021 school year, what we've added this year. We have big plans for our students, and we hear across stakeholders that this continues to be really meaningful and the right work. So we are expanding next school year to include academic goal setting and deepening implementation. And then very soon, hopefully right after that launch, we will move into a place where every student in our system has an individualized student success plan. The reason we haven't gone immediately to success plans is we're building the infrastructure to make sure we can respond to those plans. It's one thing to have a plan, and it's a whole nother thing to be able to connect students to what they need to meet their goals, to address their needs. And so we're building that infrastructure and are really excited about what's next for our for this work.
Take it from Juliet. Our work as navigators is all about connections. We all want to be known, cared for, respected, and supported. We want our students to feel like what we're putting in place, the systems, the structures, the supports, such as navigators, really truly helps them to stay connected, helps them to thrive. It's too important to leave to chance. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Allison Brune, and I am the executive director of the Iowa Center for School Mental Health. And with me, I have Brad Niebling from Iowa Department of Education, and we're here to talk about our collaboration on this new center. So I'm going to turn it over to Brad.
Great. Thanks, Allison. As Allison said, my name is Brad Niebling. I'm a bureau chief here at the Iowa Department of Education, and I wear a variety of hats, but primarily here today, I'm responsible for providing leadership around social, emotional, and behavioral health for the Department of Education here in Iowa. And I wanted to just spend a couple of minutes talking to you a little bit about our priority as a state around social, emotional, and behavioral health, and this exciting opportunity that we have to be in partnership with the University of Iowa around the Iowa Center for School Mental Health. And as we've seen across the country, is certainly true in Iowa, the needs of students around social, emotional, behavioral health have been centrally important for a long time, but really grew in importance through the pandemic. There's been growing consensus in our state, from the governor to our legislature, state agencies, districts and schools, that this is an important priority to ensure that we are supporting the needs of students, not just academically, but socially, emotionally, and behaviorally as well. And that predated the pandemic. And some of the things that I really want to highlight here is we've had legislation in our state for several years, really zeroing in on this to put both policy and resources into supporting students and families and teachers around behavioral health, including funding for therapeutic classrooms is one of the most recent pieces of legislation. A variety of projects and initiatives over the years focused on social, emotional, behavioral health, including integrating that with academics within a multi-tiered system of support. It's embedded deeply in our Every Student Succeeds Act plan. We even have a statewide conditions from learning survey that all of our schools are required to complete as part of that ESSA plan. We've had several federal grants over the years, Project AWARE, the School Climate Transformation Grant, and the Stop School Violence Grant as well. So we've been putting a lot of energy into social, emotional, behavioral health in schools predating the pandemic. And that helped really stage us for the next steps that we need to take during the pandemic. As it hit, we were offering extensive guidance, implementation resources, and supporting schools as they returned to learn. And I was one of the earliest states in the country to make sure that students were back in school as quickly and safely as possible. As part of the leveraging the federal relief dollars to support our ongoing work around social, emotional, behavioral health in response to the pandemic, we've entered into this partnership with the University of Iowa and their College of Education as they've been launching their Iowa Center for School Mental Health. We're able to, in partnership with our governor, provide $20 million of that federal relief money, ESSER II specifically, to help launch that center and hopefully accelerate the great work that they were already planning to do. So we're really grateful for this partnership. And as you can see here, our governor has made it a point and had a really positive press conference and press release around this as well back last summer, talking about how important mental health is for our students and schools and how important this partnership is with the University of Iowa, and our director, Ann Lebo, as well. has really prioritized not only social emotional behavioral health, but the work of this center, really bringing so much together across policy and practice and physical resources to accelerate our ability as a state to meet the growing demands of our students. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Allison to talk more about the center.
Yeah, thanks, Brad. I appreciate that background. And just to be clear, when we're talking about school mental health, so we're all on the same page, we are talking about the social, emotional, and behavioral well-being. So how we relate to others, how we feel, and how we act, and those things that allow students to function effectively in schools, because we know that when they don't and they have difficulty in school, they can struggle academically, they can struggle socially, they can struggle behaviorally, which often results in disciplinary consequences. And that can have both an individual impact as well as a long-term societal impact. And so we are really charged with improving outcomes in these areas. And so back in the fall, the U.S. Department of Ed put out a report or a document on how do we do that? How do we support child, student, social, emotional, behavioral, and mental health, as well as educator well-being. And so we have taken that document and those recommendations to heart and really try to follow them and make those or put those at the forefront of what we do. And so those recommendations include prioritizing wellness for each and every child, student, educator, and provider, enhancing mental health literacy and reducing stigma and other barriers to access, implementing a continuum of evidence-based prevention practices, establishing an integrated framework, leveraging policy and funding, enhancing workforce capacity, and using data for decision-making to promote equitable implementation and outcomes. And as you hear about the center today, you will see that those recommendations are woven throughout our work. So like I said, our mission is to address the social, emotional, behavioral, psychological needs in Iowa schools through research, teaching, and clinical service. And so we do that through professional learning and training opportunities, research and evaluation, as well as clinical services. This is a picture of our leadership team. So we are led at the University of Iowa College of Education by our dean, Dan Clay, who is really instrumental in establishing this collaboration with the State Department. There's a picture of me, the executive director. Carrie Vogelgesang is our director of professional development. Geerta Bardoshi is our director of research and training. Alyssa Dubay, our director of clinical services. And then Barry Schreier, who we brought in to direct education programming for higher ed. And so we really focus on these three pieces: professional development, research and training, and clinical services. I want to start by telling you some of the things that we've done in the professional development arm of the center. So our first big task or event that we took on was the Iowa Best Summit in collaboration with the State Department. We planned for this for about half of the year. And this Iowa Best stands for Behavioral, Equitable, Social, Emotional, and Trauma-Informed Health in Schools. And so we were able to host a pre-conference panel and reception that included our university president, Sean Welsh, a former Hawkeye football player, and a variety of stakeholders across the state who answered questions from legislators, from our AAAs, from advocacy groups. And that was a really great event. And then we had a day and a half of sessions that featured 1,600 participants. We also collected data on how it went and did some strategic planning for the center by engaging stakeholders who were at the conference to provide us with ideas and feedback about the direction of our center. And we have another summit planned for next fall, October 22nd, and that will be the 10th and 11th of October. October 2022. It'll be the 10th and 11th. And so save the date, get that on your calendar. Another thing that we've done with professional development is a social emotional behavioral health webinar series. It's an 8-part series. We've averaged around 300 to 400 participants, and our participants are educators, counselors, paraprofessionals, people working in schools to support the mental health of students, and they can earn free CEUs by completing the series and associated activities. So that's been very successful. We've also realized that we need to incorporate some adult wellness, particularly for our educators, our counselors, our administrators, because we're seeing attrition across the country from the field. and just the amount of stress that they're under. And so we have also offered some wellness, online wellness events, such as yoga, mindfulness, practicing nutrition, guidance, and things like that. And we're going to continue to do that to support our adults so that they can support our students. Our next steps are to create online asynchronous professional development modules that cover social, emotional, behavioral learning for educators. And so we are partnering with Blackboard, which is now Anthology. And so we hope to be launching some of those modules in the fall. On the research and training side, we've also been quite active. Our goal with research and training is to establish an interdisciplinary network of researchers where we conduct rigorous research to develop and disseminate practical tools and promote knowledge acquisition and use of evidence-based practices in schools. We are also conducting ongoing evaluation of our own center to make sure that we're meeting our goals. We are not just a center that is based in the College of Education, though we are based there. We have 12 faculty affiliated with the center, but we also have 8 affiliated faculty from the College of Public Health, Neuroscience, Medicine, Social Work, School Nursing, and Psychiatry. And so we've really tried to create this interdisciplinary team. And our affiliated faculty are involved in attending seminars. We recently hosted one with the director of the National Center for School Mental Health, Dr. Sharon Hoover. And we also will host other seminars where they will be delivering content. We provide professional development funds for them and collaborate with them on writing grants associated with the center. One of our main goals is to increase or enhance workforce capacity in the state and beyond. And so one of the ways that we're doing that is to offer assistantships for graduate students in mental health, school mental health related fields. And we view that as a way to recruit people in and retain them, and then hopefully get them out in the field working to support school mental health. We also are trying to increase our research output in this area. And so we have 7 funded research assistant positions to do research on best practices for interventions and assessments on school mental health and in the state of Iowa. Most recently, about a week ago, we just released our request for proposals. And with our funds, we are going to offer grant money up to $250,000 for 2 years to institutes of higher ed, nonprofit institutions, school districts, AEAs, who wish to conduct intervention research to improve social, emotional, behavioral, and psychological outcomes in pre-K through 12 schools. And we're really hoping that these will be interdisciplinary, cross-university, and potentially focus on rural and high-need schools where resources may be lower and there is a definite need for support. We also have within the center some research projects going on. We're doing some evaluation of the counseling and SEL programs in a local district. So we have sent out surveys to every administrator, parent, student, and teacher in the district. And we're working on preparing a report on that and then hoping to distribute that across the state to better learn what our counseling programs look like, what our perspectives are on SEL, and how we can improve programming in that area. We've also partnered with a company called Neil, who has an app to improve coping skills, manage stress, and resilience. So we have schools, two different school districts who are partnering with us on that. And what we have is teachers, educators, other adults in the building using the app. And then next fall, we're going to pilot it with high school students and develop some lessons where both the teachers and the students will be using this app to hopefully improve some their well-being. And we will be measuring outcomes on that. And then we are also going to be rolling out a study on mental health awareness training that focuses on culturally responsive practices and reducing stigma. And so that will be coming out in the fall. And then finally, we have our clinical service arm. And We have done some of the clinical services already. Mostly that's entailed crisis response, which I'll talk about in a little bit. But we will be opening an on-site clinic where there will be some screening and triage. We'll provide some consultation. We're developing a statewide referral network for when people come through the clinic. Sorry about that. We will be doing some short-term intervention and also some telehealth services because we realize that, you know, we're based in Iowa City. Not everybody can reach us. We need to reach the entire state. So that clinic is scheduled to open physically in the fall of 2022. But like I said, we are doing some crisis response. One of the big ones that we've worked on this since November is with Fairfield High School and actually their entire community. People may remember that they had a teacher who was murdered by two students. And right before that, there was actually a suicide at this school. So that community has been rocked to the core. And so we were brought in to provide some services starting over Thanksgiving. We did some telehealth services. And then our team met with each grade level of students. They provided ongoing therapy for both staff and students like every Friday. And that has continued. It's tapered off a little bit, but that is continuing through the year. And then we've also started the NEOLF app with their entire district administrators, faculty, staff. And then this summer, they're going to be participating in some wellness and mindfulness training, as well as some other professional development activities to really help that community. So what started out as crisis response has also evolved into some additional supports and services around professional development. So this map is a geographic distribution of the services and supports that we've provided. So we've been reaching a lot of people, mostly through our professional development arm. And we, you know, obviously have just started building the center as of August of this year. And one thing that's been really important to us is community partnerships. So we've done a lot of meetings with other providers in the state, with our AEAs to figure out how do we best support them and the services that they provide to schools. And so it's an ongoing process. We're really working hard and we realize that there is a bottomless need and finite resources. That's what our director, Barry Schreier, always says, and it's true. And so we hope that this center is really going to make a difference. And so far, we're already seeing that impact. If you want to connect with us, we are online. We have our website, our Facebook page, and a Twitter page. And so if you want to learn more about professional development, learning opportunities, other news and resources, you can certainly do so. And also, if you would like to reach out to either Brad or myself, those are our email addresses. We will certainly respond. That's all we have for you on the Iowa Center for School Mental Health.
Good evening. My name is Barbara Duffield, and I am the Executive Director of Schoolhouse Connection. We are a national nonprofit organization working to overcome homelessness through education. Homelessness underlies many of the pandemic recovery challenges facing schools today, everything from drops in enrollment to chronic absence to academic recovery to social and emotional health. At the same time, lack of a high school degree is the single greatest risk factor associated with homelessness as a young adult. This makes education a critical intervention for stopping homelessness. And it also means that public schools must intentionally address student homelessness if we are to move from recovery to thriving. Congress recognized the unique needs of students experiencing homelessness by approving a bipartisan amendment to the American Rescue Plan Act. This amendment provided $800 million in funding to support the identification, enrollment, and school participation of children and youth who are homeless. This funding and the work of educators to use it to meet the needs of students experiencing homelessness was also featured very recently in a front page New York Times story, One Woman Rescue Squad for Homeless Students. It's an amazing story that follows the work of the McKinney-Vento Liaison in Bastrop, Texas. Of course, students experiencing homelessness need more than a one woman rescue squad, and educators shouldn't feel like they won the lottery just when they get the resources that they need to begin to address the needs of our students. Nonetheless, it's an incredible read and really paints the picture of what this work looks like on the ground. And I want to share other examples of how school districts are using ARP funds to support students experiencing homelessness. But before I do that, I want to provide a little bit of background information, because many educators, just like the general public, may hear the word homeless and it conjures an image that doesn't necessarily match the reality of our children and our youth and our communities today. So the first thing is just to know how widespread student homelessness is. Youth homelessness is the same prevalence in rural, suburban, and urban communities. This chart here shows you the 10-year trend line. You can see spikes after natural disasters, but you could also see the numbers going down in the pandemic. We did a study with the University of Michigan in the fall of 2020, and schools reported a 28% drop in the number of identified homeless students. That wasn't because homelessness was dropping. It was because during virtual learning, the eyes and the ears of the school system weren't on these students. What we're hearing now at this point in the school year is that numbers are not only the same as pre-pandemic, but in many cases, they're much higher as the economic crisis and the family stressors continue and contribute to student homelessness. The other thing that's really important to keep in mind is just how hidden student homelessness is. When we look at where most students who are homeless are when they're first identified by public schools, they're not out where you can see them. They're not on the streets. Almost 80% of students who are experiencing homelessness when they're first identified are staying with other people temporarily, moving from place to place. Sometimes it's called couch surfing, sometimes doubled up, but it's a very hidden population. And if you think about in the pandemic, you can't social distance when you're staying with somebody else, maybe people you don't even know. You can't stay at home if you don't have a home of your own. We also know that many shelters closed down or limited their space during the pandemic, making student homelessness all that much more hidden. Looking at who experiences homelessness, most students who experience homelessness are students of color. In fact, the U.S. Department of Education now has disaggregated data on student homelessness, both at the state and at the local level. Nationally, we know that only 27% of students who are experiencing homelessness identified by public schools were white, which means the majority of students who experience homelessness are students of color. The disproportionalities that we see, you can see on this next chart, which are the populations most likely to be overrepresented among students experiencing homelessness. And students who are furthest from opportunity are the students who are more likely to experience homelessness. So we can't achieve equity in education unless we're paying attention to student homelessness. When we talk to students themselves, when students talk about or respond to questions about homelessness, in this case, in particular, high school students, we see more disproportionalities. In this case, from the Centers for Disease Control's Youth Risk Behavior Survey, we'll also ask questions about LGBT students and pregnant students who are at much higher risk of experiencing homelessness. Further looking at the intersectionality of homelessness with other learning issues, students with disabilities are overrepresented among students experiencing homelessness. Nearly 1 in 5 students who are homeless also have a documented disability, and English learners as well. So the point here is that we can't look at our at populations in silos or federal programs in silos because of all the cross-cutting issues and challenges that our students face. Homelessness also has a negative impact on graduation that's above and beyond poverty. So looking here at the high school graduation rates for 2018-2019, again, pre-pandemic, we see that students experiencing homelessness were about 12 percentage points, had a high school graduation rate that was 12 percentage points lower than other economically disadvantaged students. The barriers to enrollment, to attending on a regular basis, the trauma that accompanies homelessness, all of that contributes to lower academic outcomes for our students who are experiencing homelessness. Chronic absence is another issue for which we have some data. Again, pre-pandemic, students experiencing homelessness, about nearly 37% were chronically absent. And for the states who are sharing their data from the first full year of the pandemic, we see even higher rates of chronic absence. Over 50% of students who are homeless in Maine and Connecticut, for example, were chronically absent in 2020-2021. Health and mental health consequences are also significant for students who are experiencing homelessness. Looking again here at the Centers for Disease Control, YRBS Youth Risk Behavior Survey, just looking at one of the risk factors, we see that 28% of high school students who are experiencing homelessness reported one or more suicide attempt in the past 30 days. High school students who are homeless greater than four times more likely to attempt suicide than other students. So it's an urgent, urgent issue that we address specifically the needs of our students experiencing homelessness with American Rescue Plan funds. The infrastructure for doing that is the McKinney-Vento Act. The McKinney-Vento Act providing strong educational rights under federal law for these students to stay in the same school, be immediately enrolled, and to have that designated point person, the McKinney-Vento liaison, in every school district. Of course, the challenge pre-pandemic is that fewer than one in four school districts received direct support through the McKinney-Vento program to identify and provide assistance to our students who are experiencing homelessness. That, of course, changed with the American Rescue Plan Act. What I want to do now is focus on some major categories of activity that we see being used with American Rescue Plan funds and some specific examples of some amazing school districts and states. So the New York Times article really paints a picture of what the day in a life is of a McKinney-Vento liaison. And that staffing issue is absolutely critical in terms of providing the support our students need. They need schools, students who are homeless need trained school staff who are looking specifically for them, staying connected to them, and making connections for them. So nationally, uses of American Rescue Plan Act funds to increase the hours for the McKinney-Vento liaisons, to hire outreach specialists, housing and service navigators, academic coaches, support at both bookends, the early childhood and post-secondary, transportation coordinators, and also point people in every school building. This is one really important area of directing American Rescue Plan funds for these students. We're well aware of the staffing shortages and challenges across the country, so that we know that those challenges are real. At the same time, this is the single best use of American Rescue Plan Act funds for our students who are experiencing homelessness. Just to give one example of a school district in North Thurston, Washington State, a school district that had an infrastructure and support already in place and so was really able to pivot and use these funds well, support not just through the district practice, but also through a state law called the Homeless Student Stability Program. With a combined use of funds, North Thurston hired student navigators for every high school. The result of that was increasing the graduation rate of students who were homeless to 84% above the district average. So now, building on that success, North Thurston will use their ARP dollars to hire a bilingual student navigator to connect families to resources. And then next year, a dedicated middle school position to help those students and also help them transition to secondary education. Another big category use of funds, very strategic for students experiencing homelessness, are basic needs, communication, and transportation. Our students who are homeless are very, very mobile, moving from place to place. They have little to no control over where they're staying. They may not have phones or Wi-Fi or other means to stay in touch. They may not have anybody looking for them. And all of that uncertainty creates barriers to school, and of course, it's devastating for mental health. So other big areas of use for these funds, cell phones and data plans, again, to have a way to stay in touch when you're moving around, to have someone be able to call you if you didn't show up to school, find out why, gas cards, vehicle, car repair, store cards for basic needs so that liaisons don't have to look everywhere for a particular size shoe. They can have a store card for a family and they can get what they need to participate in school. A district spotlight in this category would be Minneapolis Public Schools. In Minneapolis, they surveyed students experiencing homelessness at the middle school and the high school level, as well as their parents, and identified three key areas for investing funds. They're going to hire a transportation scheduler, increase their use of on-demand taxis, and bring on a summer social worker focused on the mental health needs of our students experiencing homelessness. When they surveyed parents and they said, what was the biggest reason you were able to attend school on a regular basis, reliable transportation came up. So it's really a basic need that's addressed by the law, but with the American Rescue Plan funds, there's additional resources to be creative and make sure students can get to school on time. Third broad category of use of funds is community-based partnerships. The American Rescue Plan Homeless Children and Youth Funds really put a new emphasis and new freedom on using those funds to support community-based partnerships to meet the needs of students and families holistically. So some of the partnerships that we're seeing are using these funds to support connections to housing and homeless service agencies, mental health services, early childhood and institutions of higher education, and also partnering with culturally specific organizations that represent historically marginalized communities so we can do a better job identifying and supporting those students. One example in this category is Richland One in South Carolina. In Richland One, the school district will use their ARP funds to support new partnership with the NAACP and the University of South Carolina. Law students will support clinics across the district to support to provide families with access to housing navigators as well as legal resources. The American Rescue Plan funds will pay for the staff time during the clinics, but the clinics themselves don't need the funding. And this is going to make this intervention one that lasts into the future. And again, can both address the needs of students who are experiencing homelessness now, but also prevent homelessness by connecting families to legal resources as well, for example, to prevent evictions. And one final category I want to talk about here is just to recognize that the American Rescue Plan Act will potentially more than double the number of school districts who receive dedicated funding for homeless students. This will include many districts who've never gotten dedicated funding to support homeless students before, many first-time grantees. Those districts are going to need help with very basics of identification, removing barriers, and how to connect the use of federal funds to those purposes. So I want to spotlight here the Rhode Island Department of Education, which is helping its new school, the new grantee school districts connect the need that they see in their community through a simple needs assessment that directly then links to allowable and strategic uses of funds for American Rescue Plan Act. We've got some links here in the PowerPoint about exactly how they're doing that and even the sample needs assessment that can be replicated by other states and other districts too. Finally, in wrapping up, we know we can't go back. We're not going back to pre-pandemic education in any arena. But we also have to look forward, what we've learned about this experience that we can carry into the future. And for us, that means looking at the policy recommendations that will address the hidden crisis of student homelessness that's underlying so many of our challenges today. So five recommendations. First of all, the $800 million, it's just under 2% of K-12 education funding. It really needs to be the new normal. We need to be at least having this level of investment to support schools and students moving forward. We also know we need to do a better job of targeting existing resources to sustain the programs that have been created through the American Rescue Plan Act. And that means better use of Title I Part A set-asides for homeless students, required under federal law, but really woefully underutilized to sustain programming. We also know that we need to McKinney-Vento-ize the bookends of K-12 education on early childhood and post-secondary and work with our partners there to ensure the full spectrum of learning, the full learning continuum is intentionally meeting the needs and identifying these students. State policy plays a critical role in addressing everything from the disproportionate impact of school discipline to credit accrual and graduation, access to health and mental health for unaccompanied youth who are experiencing homelessness. So the federal policy is very strong, but the state policies can go much further and be more specific. And so that's an area of reform looking forward that we need to carry forward. And then finally, the connection to housing and homeless services. There are many barriers that our students still face to addressing even existing resources, whether it's because they don't qualify or because of the way the service delivery system is set up. So those school housing partnerships, from setting aside housing vouchers for school-identified families as exists in Boston and Chicago and Minneapolis, distributing rental assistance through schools to prevent homelessness, and ensuring that our high school students or unaccompanied youth have a stable place to stay during high school too through host homes for unaccompanied youth. We've got a lot of resources for you, everything from checklists to allowable uses of funds. And again, those spotlights, those best practices. We are releasing a one feature per week about how school districts and states are using American Rescue Plan Act funds. That's the last hyperlink on this slide, and would encourage everyone to check those out and get some inspiration for how to support our students who are experiencing homelessness. Thanks very much.